Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam upon all the messengers of Allah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. One day in the old days, a noble messenger asked Allah a very strange question. He said, Rabbi, arini kayfa tuhyi al-mawta. My Lord, show me how you give life, how you revive the dead. And even more stranger is the answer back of Allah to this man, Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah says back, Qal, awalam tu'min, haven't you believed? Aren't you a believer in me? Then Ibrahim, even more strangely, answers back, Bala, no. So Ibrahim is telling Allah, no, the reason I asked you the question is not because I am not a believer. Walakin, but liyatma'inna qalbi, so that my heart is completely satisfied of what you do, that you revive the dead. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on telling Ibrahim how Allah would revive the dead right in front of his very eyes. Then he tells him, خُذْ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الطَّيْرِ, take four birds. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ, then of course you're going to slaughter them, and then you're going to kill them, and then you're going to tear their bodies apart, and then go to different parts of mountains, and then on each mountain put a lump of the meat from the birds. Either you put each bird or you mix them together or whatever. And then Allah tells Ibrahim, then you go in the middle of them all mountains, and then you, ya Ibrahim, call them. Then Ibrahim did exactly that. He went on and then he calls the birds, and subhanallah, the deed of Allah, Allah gave back life to these slaughtered, completely cut, completely taken into pieces, those birds. And when Ibrahim calls them, the different pieces of the meat just fly back to, they didn't literally fly, but they came to Ibrahim, and as soon as they reached Ibrahim, they were completely made up birds. The birds that Ibrahim just slaughtered a little ago, here they are right in front of Ibrahim. And then Allah adds a very interesting end to this ayah, and he tells Ibrahim, wa'alam, and then he tells him, no, inna Allah, that Allah is indeed aziz, mighty, powerful, hakim, wise. And you can see the whole story that Allah tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah, that's Surah number 2, the ayah 260. So why did I start my talk about what has Allah written with this story? I will tell you a little bit later why I started with this story. In this very pre-installment, or if you will, this before the end of the talk about the decree and predestination as we know them, we will finally discover and understand the many factors that shape our lives on earth. And I mean these factors like we face every single day, those beliefs that drive us, the morals, the relationships that we have with different people on earth, starting from ourselves to our kids, to our spouse, to our family, and all that are surrounding us, how we perceive our loved ones, and even how we conceptualize our relationship with our own God, Allah. So there are so many factors. Literally what I'm saying here is that are so many factors that play a huge role in the way we are and how we look at life. Even if one individual event takes place, we humans interact with that event differently from each other, and each of us takes something different from that event. So these factors, my sisters and my brothers, they also affect life in general. And I mean the animals, nature as we know it, oceans, and everything that surrounds us. In this very particular talk, and especially in the next one, so these two talks are the most dangerous talks, the most revealing talks, the most truth revealing talks that you will ever hear in your entire lives. What I'm going to share with you in this talk here about what has Allah written, and the next talk, inshallah, you've never heard anything like it. I'm telling you this, why? Because it's kind of like a pre-warning. What I'm going to tell you is not something totally new. It already is in Al-Quran. But since the way Islam is designed today, it's designed really far off from the Quran. And that's why even when people read the Quran, they read it with the eyes of what man, of the man of the religion, also known as the Sheikh and the scholars, prefer to tell people. And as such, people will just take the Islam based on what they have indoctrinated. It's not what they have gathered themselves from the Quran. You will actually, and once and for all, start to really discover and know Allah like you never ever have before. Your relationship with Allah is going to change, and believe me on that one. And also you're going to have, you want to know Allah. Just like how he wants it, not how the man of religion or the hadith or the sunnah or the scholars have painted Allah. The way Allah today is for us Muslims, we don't understand really what Allah is. I find pleasure in asking people, what does Allah mean to you? And you won't believe it. People give you some answers, some generic answers. We see in these days we have Christians, and they say when something happens and they win the battles, like nowadays they are the top ones, what? They always say thank to God for helping us. The Jews, they say thank to God for helping us. We Muslims say thank to God for helping us. The Hindus, thank to God. Each one on earth, whenever they accomplish something, they thank Allah. As if high above in the heavens, there are 600 gods. And each one is calling. We kind of like have become like the Greeks before Zeus and all these people. Okay? But in this talk, what I am about to reveal in this talk is already out there in the Quran. And at this point here, my dear sisters and my brothers, it is very worth saying that all messengers and all prophets got the knowledge that I'm going to share with you in this talk and in the next one as part of their prophethood package. When they become prophets, they get educated. They receive the knowledge that I'm going to tell you about today. But also, for you and I, since we are not prophets and we are not messengers, guess what? And we have the Quran of Allah right in between our hands, what is asked of us, what is demanded from us, is that we study the Quran to get this knowledge from the mouth of the dragon, so to speak. To help us discover this, who Allah he is and what he does and all that thing, Allah has embellished the Quran, this glorious book, with all kinds of secrets to help us unlock this powerful information that is in Al-Quran. You see, if passing a PhD exam was at the mercy of every human out there, PhD will not have the value of what it has today. So to get a master's degree or whatever degree you want, you study very hard to get it, right? And that's why when you get the degree, you get higher position, you get higher wages, and you get a better life than the normal day-to-day person in this life. So the same thing, Allah wants to give us a lot of results. It'll give us a lot of rewards for the hereafter. But he's not going to make it easy for you to get these things. He has embellished the Quran with so many beautiful things, and he told us in the Quran, study these things. You will reach the truth. You will reach what I want from you. The more you study the Quran, the more you will understand what I want from you, what I'm telling you, and the more rewards we give you. Al-Quran was never ever recite one letter, you get 10 good deeds. This is man-made stories to encourage people to just concentrate on reading the Quran to accomplish a great number of good deeds. They never ever tell you, if you understand one ayah, you get that great of a deal. Today, Muslims, we concentrate more on memorizing the Quran as opposed to understanding the command of Allah. Okay, so to help us, as I said, discover this, Allah has embellished the Quran with all kinds of secrets, and it is up to us to search for this powerful information. In today's and the next talk, you will open your eyes to what Allah wants you to open your eyes to. Not what politicians and their servants, i.e. the men of religion, scholars and sheikhs, wanted and still want you to see. You see, Allah has given you the Qur'an because He wants you to see something. But the men of religion, to serve politics, have turned the whole thing upside down, and you are actually seeing Islam through their eyes, through their sayings, not through what Allah says in Al-Qur'an. In a way or another, Muslims today that have existed right from the death of Rasulullah ﷺ until today have always been the product or the produce of a human-designed and shaped Islam. Guess what? We get married not according to the Qur'an, but according to the man-made sunnah and hadith. We divorce according to the man-made sunnah and hadith. We fast according to the man-made sunnah and hadith. We do hajj or we hajj according to the sunnah and hadith. We do the wudu according again to the sunnah and hadith. We do our salat according to the sunnah and hadith, and all these are man-made. And we bury our dead according to man-made sunnah and hadith. We bring our children up according to man-made sunnah and hadith. We celebrate the birth of our children according to how the man-made sunnah and hadith tells us. And of course, you know, the female children, you slaughter only one animal, and for the boys, you slaughter two. And you see, the chauvinism and discrimination start at a very early life, even though the Prophet himself slaughtered one animal for each of his two grandchildren. So for Al-Hasan, he slaughtered one, and Al-Husayn, he slaughtered the other one. But the question to ask here, why didn't Ali do it? Why did they leave it to the grandfather? So if it is all sunnah and we go the pathway of the sunnah, then each time the child is born, it is the grandfather that should slaughter, because that's what the Messenger of Allah did. You see, it's all man-made to push people to do certain things. And we also inherit according to man-made sunnah and hadith. It is impossible that Allah talks about inheritance in Al-Quran in a very clear way, but our scholars differ and they disagree and they argue and they get into all this kind of confusion from the Quran. It's impossible that the Quran, Allah says, it's easy and humans have turned it into a very complicated matter. So much so that they misunderstood, believed or not, that the share of one boy equals two of the women. And Allah never said this in Al-Quran. And the reason why they understood it this way, it's because initially they believe that the kid, the boy, is far better than the girl. But Allah does not say this, and I'm not going to make a talk. Maybe in the future, inshallah, we'll cover this issue. What has been chosen and designed as Islam right after the death of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, till these days, is an Islam based on the man-made sunnah and hadith, rather from what Allah wants in His Quran. This is why I start my talk convincing you to believe in what Allah says in the Quran. Because if I just told you what Allah says in the Quran like that, you won't accept it, because you have been indoctrinated. It's the brainwash that the sunnah and hadith are all. Listen to people today, they always tell you, oh, it is sunnah to do this, it is sunnah to do that. Nobody tells you, Allah says this, Allah says that. My dear sisters and my brothers, the apparent human involvement in our Islam, how they shaped Islam, is really crystal clear. But because the ingenious ways on how the carpet of manipulation have been pulled from under our feet right in front of our noses, and how the scholars have shaped Islam and they made it appear as if it is the Islam, so we became Muslims so numb, and we can't even figure out the truth from the Quran, even if the Quran spells it out for us, letter by letter, we still find it very difficult to trust the Quran. Again, all these problems have always lived on. But one thing and only one thing changed the rule of the game. The internet. When internet came in, Allahu Akbar. Today I'm here in London speaking and making my talk, and then my talk is going to be heard over all the world, wherever people listen and whatever. And guess what? In no time, people in America gonna hear what I gotta say. And suddenly, all that media driven by politics and the sheikh and all these things is challenged by gazillions of people. Before the coming of the internet, the government would recruit sheikhs, overpraise them, over-amplify their worth and titles, and you always hear Sheikhul Islam. Sheikhul Islam means the highest authority in Islam. It's not the messenger of Allah. It's not the Qur'an. It's Ibn Taymiyyah. It's Ibn Baz. It's Ibn Uthaymin. It's Fawzan. It's Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. It's these people that have become suddenly the highest authority of Islam. And when they tell you that, anyone who opens their mouth is actually attacking the highest authority of Islam. They tell you the flesh of the scholars is poisoned and you cannot criticize. Whatever they say, they become like a god. Whatever they say works. And this is not the truth. That's why they over-amplify the sheikh, and then they tell you, like I heard one day somebody introducing a sheikh from Saudi Arabia, Al-Fawzan, and this man in front of a huge audience, and the tape got recorded and everything, so I heard it here in London and it was not there. He said, Al-Fawzan is a companion that has traveled through time to our times. And then he said, Al-Fawzan is a gift from Allah as a companion to us. How can you challenge Al-Fawzan with this kind of description? And when Muslims hear this kind of lies told in such a way, and they told in a big television by people, of course people have this tendency to believe. You say it here, you say it there, you say it here, you say it there, and people start taking those myths and those lies as something of the truth. And again, if you want to know the impact of groups on the decree on predestination, please do go back to my talk, the third one, titled The Decree on Predestination and Politics or Birth of the Groups. My dear sisters and my brothers, because Islam has always been a very handy tool for the government and their agents, the sheikhs, to control the masses, and because governments all the time since the death of Rasulullah until today, all governments are against each other, the Islam that we created, or those scholars have created and preached, is only fueled and still fuels the Muslim disunity. Because governments are against each other, the sheikhs are against each other, people are against each other, and that's why you find Muslims today very disunited, even though the Qur'an calls to unity, and the Qur'an is simple in what it calls, but we still are disunited for one fact, because we are not following the Qur'an. Now, the reason, why am I telling you all this before I get to how Allah has, what Allah has written and the knowledge of Allah and all these things? Because the impact of what the humans have programmed, your mind is so strong. If I tell you right on about Allah, you're not gonna believe it even though it is in Al-Quran. But you ain't gonna believe it because you have been brainwashed into prioritizing the hadith and the sunnah and the sayings of the scholars over what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. We are, the Muslims throughout history, victim of a very dark past. How can we trust in history when the present time in our time is being falsified and played up with for future generations right in front of our very eyes? How can you trust in what has happened in the past when you see the present historians, they lie and they write history not as it happened? Exactly what happened before happens here, except for one and only book, and that is Al-Quran. Again, I can hear you say, what does all this got to do with what Allah has written, brother? Just get into the matter. And you are very right to ask this question. And my answer to your question is this. The reason I chose this introduction was to highlight what kings and politicians and sheikhs and scholars have done to Islam. How they ganged up against the Quran, the only and unique beating heart of of Islam on Judgment Day, there will only be the Qur'an and the Qur'an alone. They will absolutely not be any reference to a hadith or sunnah or the siwak and all those things that we people base Islam on today. They will be absolutely irrelevant on Judgment Day. So I want to emphasize the importance of the Quran. On number two, how politics isolated the Quran from our lives today and for the last 1400 years. Al Quran has been isolated from people's lives so much so that people believe what the hadith says more than what the Quran says. People have a huge difficulty accepting what Allah says. After all, it is Allah who sent a messenger. In our conceptualization, it is far more, it's the messenger who's doing favor to Allah, and then he can do and he can preach and he can change at will. So here, I'm putting the track back on track again. Okay, number three, to bring the light to the ill doings of scholars and sheikhs and how they again played up with the scripture of the Quran. You see, they could not change the wordings of the Quran, but they changed the meaning of what Allah intended through the books of tafsir and the hadith and what today they think that they say, they changed. So when you read the ayah in the Quran, you're not going to understand what Allah says, but rather more understand it based on what you have been taught. The fourth reason is that the biggest crime ever committed was to remove the Quran as the beating heart of Al-Islam and replace it with the man-made Sunnah and Hadith. You see, in the third century, and the third century starts from the year 200 and up, when Muslims wrongly started invading other countries, and then people from different cultures came to Islam, and they exactly came to Baghdad because of that moment there. It was the capital of the Abbasid dynasty. There were the Persians, there were the Romans, there were all kinds of people from the entire world. Back in time, Baghdad and the Muslim world was like Europe and the Americas are today. The people would migrate to these lands. So when people came from different lands, they came to our to our Islamic state back then, and the Muslims of that time, the scholars, instead of giving the Quran, the message of Allah to mankind, what they did, they presented the Prophet Muhammad as the utmost authority of Islam. Do you know why they did that? Because when people came from Persia, they brought some prophets from Persia. They say, oh, this prophet, they did this, they did that, all those miracles. When the Jews came in, they brought what Musa alayhi salam did, when the Christians did, when these Zoroastrians and the Hindus, Buddha, all those people, all those religions at that time there, they were based on humans. So when they came to Islam, to the way we are today, they find out that actually our Prophet doesn't have a single miracle but the Quran. So for people to accept Muhammad as a messenger and all that kind of stuff, they attributed to this man far more than the Quran. And Al-Islam's centricity, the heart of Al-Islam, was removed, i.e. the Quran, and another pace-made heart or fake heart or transplanted heart was put in the body of Al-Islam, and that heart was the Sunnah and the Hadith and things like that. And the Islam we have today, apparently the physics, the body is Islam, but the beating heart is not Islam, because the Quran is not as it ought. You can't tell me, no, I believe in the Quran, I follow the Quran. I want you to tell me this after you hear this talk and the next one, and what Allah says, and then we're gonna see. And I'm gonna give you some things that you believe in unquestionably, like you don't doubt them a split of a second. And you'll be absolutely amazed and shocked that what you believe in is 100% wrong. The Quran says exactly the opposite. Let me give you a few examples. Number one, every Muslim out there believes that on Judgment Day, there will be some Muslims who have committed a lot of sins in this life. They will enter hellfire, be punished, and then they will be taken out from hellfire restored back to how they were in this big river called the Bigger of Life, and then they'll be taken to a paradise, and they will enter there and enjoy. And those people, they will get at least 10 times better than this life. Other hadiths also say that when Muslims are in paradise, in hellfire, being punished and tortured and all that kind of stuff, there will also be a prophet and us Muslims who will go to Allah and ask for his permission to intercede on behalf of these people and take them out of hellfire. Authentic hadiths may report that Allah will tell us, okay, go to hellfire and take any Muslim who ever said La ilaha illallah. Then the hadith says that Muslims will go there and they will take out of hellfire anyone that ever said La ilaha illallah. Then they will go back to Allah and they will say, Ya Allah, there are other people who were Muslims once, and they say your name. Then Allah, until it gets to a point where Allah sends those people to hellfire and tells them, get out from hellfire anyone that has an atom weight of belief. Take them out from hellfire and take them into paradise. You all know this, right? Well, let me tell you, all this is absolutely a myth. 100% a myth. Listen to the owner of Judgment Day, what he tells his messenger. This statement is not for me, it's not for you, it's not for anybody else. It's for the messenger of Allah. Listen to this. أَفَمَنْ حَقَّ عَلَيْهِ كَلِمَةُ الْعَذَابِ. As for the one who has deserved the decision of punishment and torture, i.e. on Judgment Day, Allah has decided that a person is going to go to hellfire and is going to be tortured and punished in hellfire. Then Allah tells the Prophet Muhammad and he tells him, أَفَأَنْتَ تُنْقِذُ مَنْ فِي النَّارِ. Are you the one who is going to rescue the one or the ones that I have decided to punish and torture in hellfire? In another translation of this ayah, it reads, what about the one who has been sentenced to punishment? Can you rescue those already in the fire? And the answer is, of course not. If Allah tells the messenger that you will not be able to rescue those that are already in hellfire, that Allah has decided to punish in hellfire, how did we come up with all this story that people in hellfire will be rescued by the intercession and then by the beliefs and things like that? This is why what the Quran says is different than what is preached out there. 2, life in the final abode. People in the hereafter will split into 2 groups, a group to hellfire and another group to paradise. Again, as we know, that some of them, they will go to hellfire, be punished, and then go to Jannah. And we said that is not going to happen. Anyone who enters hellfire will never, ever enter paradise. And anyone who enters Jannah will never, ever go to hellfire. What about those people that have been good in life, but they didn't believe and they don't deserve eternity in hellfire? Well, Allah in the Quran has split people into 4 groups. 2 groups for hellfire and 2 groups for paradise. One group in hellfire will dwell in there and be tortured and punished for eternity. They will never, ever come out from hellfire. They will never, ever come out of there. And the other group that is in hellfire, but to a less degree, weren't as bad as the other ones, and they don't deserve eternity, what happens to them? They get punished for the crimes that they have made, and then they will die. Death, as you know it, but this death here is for oblivion. They will not be resurrected. The people will just lose themselves and they will become totally into oblivion. Okay, so one group will stay eternally in hellfire, the other group will be punished and then they die. But when it comes to paradise, Jannah, guess what? One group will stay there for eternity. They will never, ever come out of paradise. But there are some Muslims who have been goody-ish, but they don't deserve to stay eternally in paradise. And these people, they will be rewarded for the good deeds that they did on earth. Then they will also die into oblivion. And at the end of it, after the two groups have died, there will only remain in Jannah people that will never come out of Jannah, and those who will stay in hellfire to never come out of hellfire. That's what the Qur'an says. You see how it is completely different than what you have always believed in? Okay? Number three, all this what I'm saying here now, I'm just giving you pointers of those things. But inshallah, in future, I'm going to do talks, the evidences and all those things, and you will get to understand what Allah truly say in Al-Quran. Number three, humans come from pure sources. Okay? Unlike the man-made hadith. What I mean by that? We know that every time a couple has sex with each other, or a married couple, then what they do, when you sleep with your partner, what is the first thing you do before you do salat? You perform ghusl, right? Now, Allah, and why do you perform ghusl? Because in our fiqh, what the scholars say, and the man-made hadith, they say that sperm is impure. So the moment you have sex, go wash yourself, and then you take a whole bath and things like that, and only then will you be able to perform salat. Now, Allah in Al-Quran has described sperm with many attributes, but none of these attributes or descriptions ever meant that the sperm is impure or unclean or dirty or filthy or polluted or wicked or anything. And that once the sperm comes out of you, it necessitates a whole body wash of the secretion, okay? You secrete sperm or have sex, then they tell you, you gotta go and wash yourselves. So what exactly makes sperm impure? Nothing as far as from the Quran is concerned. And all is inside the minds of those men who decided out of their own minds to qualify sperm as dirty, unclean, filthy, polluted, and wicked matter, which in retrospect means that we humans, we come from a filthy source. If the sperm is impure, okay, then you and I are impure, because what is impure cannot give pure. And Allah in the Quran has established that we humans, Allah has created us in the best of forms, in the best of forms, and we are not impure. Okay, nothing from the Quran at all says that sperm is impure. As a matter of fact, the Islam of the Quran, if you have sex with your partner, you are not to take a shower. There is nothing wrong. You can just have sex and go make wudu and carry on your life as you. Remember in winter, how many times you wanted to sleep with your spouse and then you thought about the cold weather, going to the showers and then you quit? How many times, how many salat did you miss because the fajr come in and you are cold and you just don't want to go into the shower and take a bath? How many? All these will be on the necks of these men who invented this ridiculous law that sperm is impure and we have sex with your partner, you take ghusl and things like that. Allah doesn't say it in the Quran, and I will cover this inshallah in future. Again, number four, entrance to paradise and hellfire. It is preached, and every Muslim is very well aware of as-sirat. As-sirat is the bridge. They say it's thinner than a hair, sharper than the sharpest of swords, and on Judgment Day, humans will have to cross that bridge, and those who are destined to hellfire will fall right on into hellfire. Plenty hadith speak about this, and all this is absolutely nonsense. Al-Quran states that humans will enter paradise through gates and through to hellfire through gates. But you see, the Quran says, the hadith say, what do you believe in? So far, I've already spoken about four. There are hundreds of issues that Muslims believe in that don't exist in the Quran. This is why I tell you, we have a parallel Islam. We don't have the true Islam. The true Islam is the one in the Qur'an. The true Islam that is in the Qur'an is what sounds to you right now. As what is... What? Whoa, really? What are you saying? That I can just go pray after I slept with my wife or my husband without taking ghusl? I tell you yes. And you will find it difficult to accept this. Guess what? Because you have been brainwashed into the shower business. Let me go to number five. Okay? On Judgment Day, we are told that there is only one scale that's going to weigh our actions, right? The Quran doesn't say that. On Judgment Day, there is not just one single balance or scale that's going to, but rather a series of balances and scales. You see, your actions won't be just put in a book and the book is weighed. No. Your salat has got a scale. Your fasting has got a scale. Your truth, when you speak, you lie or you're not, has got a scale. Charity has got a scale. Each and every single deed of the humans, the category, has got its own scale. So Allah will go to the scale of truthfulness and will weigh your truthfulness, all where you had to be truthful. And then you weigh, and then charity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes your action of charity to the scale of charity. Salat, to the scale of salat. Hajj, to the scale of hajj. Being good to your parents, to the scale of being good to your parents. And then the average of all these scales is gathered, and if you pass the mark, and that is your good deeds are higher than the evil ones, then you pass, you go to paradise. And again, it doesn't mean you're going for eternity, because if your good deeds will take you there, and when I speak about paradise, I will tell you the deeds that Allah has mentioned in Al-Quran that will give you an eternal abode in paradise, and those deeds that will guarantee you only a specific time in paradise, then you will die. It's all in Al-Quran. Al-Quran was never meant to be sang in Taraweeh and people just go there to mark their presence and go home, or just pick up a Quran and sing it, and that's all there is to that. No, there is more to Al-Quran than that. Number six, Allah is not merciful by default. And this is a great calamity, that we think Allah is merciful, that you can do. Allah is not an easygoing God that craves our love and attention, and that He is all ready to mercy any of us that requires or demands it. On Judgment Day, Allah is very demanding, very unfriendly. He is very not a team player at all. He is very unforgiving. In fact, He is so unforgiving that He will judge humanity on the smallest way of a deed. The atom and less of that deed, Allah will ask for His right. So don't take Allah for a ride. He lets you do as you free on earth. But once you bounce back to Him, He will show you who He truly is. That's what Allah, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Al-Quran makes it very clear to the Prophet Muhammad and to us after him that He has written upon Himself mercy, and only Allah writes upon Himself what originally is not there. So when Allah has written upon Himself to be merciful, because for some deeds people deserve to be annihilated and completely punished to oblivion, but Allah has written upon Himself to be merciful, and as such He be merciful. For example, I don't want to give you an example here. I will cover this later on. Now, number seven, Allah is as emotional as you and I. He loves, He hates. He feels sorry. He feels deceived. He feels betrayed. And He responds in kind for what humans do to Him. Allah loves to surprise and seek our help for things He cannot do. I will tell you, Allah has written upon Himself certain laws. For example, to make a baby, Allah waits on humans to do their job so that he can give the result of that job. Can he create humans without the intersection between two humans? Of course he can. And he did that for Jesus, and look, they made Jesus his son. If humans today, we had this ability to say, I was born without a father, imagine how many kids will be out there that all of them, they claim that Allah created them without a father. But Allah wrote a rule upon himself that the only way for him to create a new child is through the help of the parents. We do it, the baby comes in. We don't do it, there is no baby in there. And in many parts of the Quran, Allah has sought the humans to help him. Hasn't he asked us to lend him some money? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُقْرِضُ اللَّهَ قَرْضًا حَسَنًا? Who is there to give Allah, to lend him a good portion of the money and things like that? Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as emotional as you and I, and emotions do make Allah do things that normally he wouldn't do. Exactly for the people of Nuh and many people that he destroyed. Why do you think he destroyed? He destroyed them because he was just happy and he destroyed them? Of course not. They angered Allah. And to angry somebody who is has written himself upon himself to be merciful, to angry somebody like that, so much so that he destroys people, it means that the emotions became strong in Allah and he destroys that. They tell you Allah is out of time, right? But that's not true. Allah has got a time, but his time is different to ours. One day in Allah's world, in Allah's existence, it was 1,000 of hours. في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة أو 1,000 سنة. On judgment day, there is the last day of hours, and then we'll start the other days, the counting of Allah. Allah exists in a space and time, and he has chosen that for himself. Now, the bonus tip, and the last one, and this one is going to absolutely surprise you to the core. Okay, and this is why we humans today live in a world of confusion. Okay, just like Allah has written upon himself to be merciful in some circumstances, okay, he also in over 20 ayat in the Quran directly he says this, and in above 100 ayat he says it indirectly, and maybe 200 to 500 ways he said in Al-Quran that Allah has chosen. Get ready. Allah has chosen not to know the future. Allah does not know the future of what's going to happen. Now you're going to tell me, hey, Allah says he knows the unseen. Yes, al-ghayb wa shahada, as Allah says in Al-Quran, al-ghayb, the unseen, is something that exists, but you don't see it. For example, your son, your grandfather, your uncle, your auntie, your home country, your friends, all these people are unseen to you. The people who die, they are unseen to you and to me and to everyone else. These, Allah knows them, as Allah says in the Quran. But for the future that has not existed, that future doesn't exist, and Allah has chosen not to know the future. This is why at the beginning I started with the story of Ibrahim, when he told him, my Lord, show me how you revive the dead people. Now, Allah, if Allah knew the future, Allah would never ever have asked Ibrahim, why don't you believe in me? And then Ibrahim says, no, I believe in you. I just want to see that, and so that my heart is at rest with the fact that you can revive the dead. And then Allah tells him, okay, if Allah knew what Ibrahim was going to say, Allah would have cut him all short, and he would have done it before Ibrahim have asked him. Another example, when the children, Allah says about the children of Israel, that وَلَقَدْ اخْتَرْنَاهُمْ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عَلَىٰ الْعَالَمِينَ, and we have picked them up, the children of Israel, based on information existing at that time of Allah over the entire world. Now, was Allah correct in his choice? No, he was not correct about it. That's why the children of Israel, what they did later on, they worshipped the cow, they disobeyed, they did. And when they disappointed Allah, when they turned out not as Allah expected them to be, what did Allah do? He punished them. He made them all, كَتَبْنَا عَلَيْهُمْ الذِّلَّةِ, total humbleness, people don't like them, whatever. Adam عليه السلام, when Allah created Adam, did he know that Adam was going to eat from the tree? Allah didn't know that Adam was going to eat from the tree. Allah warned Adam not to eat from the tree. Allah warned Adam not to listen to a shaitan. Allah did, but Allah didn't know if Adam was going to uphold his bet or not. And he said this in Surah Taha openly. وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ أَدَمَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَنَسِيَ وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. And we have trusted Adam before, i.e. we have told him not to do this. What did Adam do? He forgot, and we found Adam very weak in his decisions. So Allah trusted Adam, Adam failed. And as I told you, there are hundreds of examples in Al-Quran where Allah openly says that I'll give you just an example. Allah says to people, وَقُلْ يَعْمَلُوا, and say, work, do good deeds. فَسَيَرَ اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ, Allah will see how good you will perform. And because these people lived in a community and the Prophet was alive, then Allah says, وَرَسُولَ, and the messenger will also see how good you are. وَالْمُؤْمِنُ, and the believer will see how good you are. And as I said, I will cover this topic later. Because Allah has taken it upon himself not to know the future, nobody can come on judgment day and tell him, Ya Allah, it is you who have decided for me. When you kill somebody, it is your own self. Now, I want to emphasize something before I move on here. As I said, this is the next talk that I'm going to talk about, is Allah not knowing the future. Okay? This is the next talk. But I want to say this thing here. Allah says in the Quran that Allah يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ فَحْذَرُوا. Allah knows what is within you, so be careful and be mindful of him. What it means? It means like you right now, anything that you think of that comes to your mind, that comes to your heart, anything, as soon as you have it, Allah knows it. Okay? But anything where you are going to be next year at this very time, if you have not thought it, if you have not documented, if you have, you've got no clue what you're going to be doing next year, then Allah doesn't know it. Because if he knows it, it means he has already decided for you. Judgment day comes and you're going to tell him, look, it's you, you knew it ahead of time. It means you knew I was going to do it. It means you've written it. And we can actually accuse Allah of anything. As I said, this is for next the talk. Okay? So now that we have gone all this, and all this is in the Quran, wallahi, I swear to you, Allah in Al Quran told us that he doesn't know the future. He knows the unseen that exists, but is not seen. Okay? But he does not know the future. This is why when he sent Musa to Fir'aun, Allah told him, go to Fir'aun, speak to him, maybe he will get back to his sense and stop from being transgressant and all these things. If Allah knows the future, he wouldn't say that. So Allah sent Musa with a 50-50 opportunity chance for Fir'aun. Either he will listen to Musa and listen to what he's got to say, and then do good, or he doesn't. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was 50. This is why Allah knows whenever you're going to do something, Allah knows all the options available to you, but he doesn't know which one you are going to choose. And there are some surah, parts of the Quran at the end, when humans choose their own actions, guess what? Allah doesn't even mention his name in the surah. For example, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ, that everybody recites. Because it is an action choice surah. Allah hasn't mentioned his name at all in that and few other surahs. Why? Because it's you who choose to be a believer or not. Okay, now this should be enough. Let me now start by mentioning why people hold the belief that all of our deeds have been already decided for us. Okay, why all that happens to us, why it is preached that all that is happening to us or going to happen to us is as such because Allah had already tailored that deed to you. The general belief in the Salafist or those people who claim this this group of people, they always tell you that Allah knew ahead of time what you were gonna do, and all he did was create you, and he wrote for you what he knew you are gonna do it, you're gonna do, and as such all what you're doing is what you deserve. And this is absolutely untrue. On judgment day, if Allah tells me, Abdusalam, you're going to hellfire, I will argue until the cows come home, and I'll tell him, why should I go home? It is you who knew I was going to become like this. Why didn't you change me? Why did you let me all my life performing salat, and now you tell me I'm going to hellfire? Why didn't you do something? Didn't I make dua for you? Didn't say ihdina sirat al-mustaqim? Didn't I make dua, ya Allah, safeguard me from hellfire? Why did you choose to ignore me? You can win the argument down. But on judgment day, if you open your mouth, or if I open my mouth with such an argument, Allah will say, didn't I say in the Quran that I don't know the future and that I don't know what you are gonna do? All I do is I gave you what's right and what's wrong, and my angels were there documenting what you were doing, and you were at all time free to do what you want. I'm gonna say yes. And then he's gonna say, did I write what you were gonna do? I'm gonna say no. And if I say yes, he's going to say, show me where in the Quran did I say that? And I won't be able to prove that. Nobody can. It is impossible. But what our scholars did, they couldn't change the wordings, but they manipulated and they played with their version of how they translated what Allah said, and here we are today. This is why when they want to prove that everything has been written against you ahead of time, they cannot use the Quran, but rather use the following four hadith. Number one, and this hadith is in al-Bukhari, a man said, I'm going to just say the English because I'm tired of translating. It's going to take longer, so I'm just going to, except when it comes to the Quran. A man said, Messenger of Allah, can the people of paradise be known, i.e. differentiated right now, from the people of fire? And the Prophet replied, yes. You know the people who have made up these stories on Judgment Day? I really don't want to be in their place, because this is a lie, contradicts the Quran 100%. You will see this. Then the man said, so why do people try to do good deeds then? Why people try to do good deeds and knowing that Allah already knows that they're going to go to hellfire? And here is the big lie, or at least what the hadith says in al-Bukhari, the Prophet said, and I'm certain, 1000% sure he didn't say this, but that, hey, that's what it is. They say, everyone will do the deeds for which they have been created to do. Or they will do those deeds which will be made easy for him or her to do. I.e., everybody will find easy to do such deeds as will lead him or her to their destined place for which they have been created. So if what in other simplistic ways, this is what they're saying. If Allah has decided you are going to go to hellfire, then he would have created you, created the deeds that will lead you to hellfire, and you will only do those deeds and you will go to hellfire. End of it. So in other words, when you perform your salat and it is not actually you who decide to perform it, but rather it is Allah who decides to, that I'm going to perform the salat. You see, if Allah has written everything, that means if you stand in your salat, you're doing absolutely nothing. Because as the story goes, Allah has decided that your salat is going to be a lousy one. That you're going to dream and you're going to think about this. He's not going to give you the good deeds, and you might as well pray or not pray, your end is hellfire. Does this make sense? Does this make Allah wise? No, absolutely not. It's like somebody who programs their car to jump off a cliff, then they go to the car and blame the car for jumping off the cliff. Hey, it's you who programmed the whole thing. This kind of hadith means one thing is bye-bye free choice. And this is 100% man-made hadith. And of course, they throw the Qur'an all out of the window, in the trash, wherever. And this is extremely very sad. And of course, the Prophet hasn't said this, but this is what is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, and the books of hadith. Now, number two, hadith number two, and this hadith is also authentic. It's reported in Malik, At-Tirmidhi, and Abu Dawud. A man called Muslim ibn Yasar al-Juhani said, when Umar ibn al-Khattab was asked about this verse, when your Lord took their offspring from the backs of the children of Adam, and their descendants, and made them testify of themselves, am I not your Lord? They said, of course you are, and we have testified. Then Allah said, lest you should say on judgment day, indeed we were of these heathens. Basically, that Allah has taken what we call the covenant, and Allah has taken that covenant from us, and he asked us a question, all of us, generation after generation after generation, and each generation Allah asks them, am I not your Lord? And then we say, yes, you are our Lord. Then Allah says, you will bear witness to this. We say, yes. Then he said, don't come back to me on judgment day, and you say we are headless of this. We say, of course not. Then Allah takes the generation, our kids, from our back, okay, and then each time he takes a new generation, the other generation goes back into oblivion, ready for creation. This is why there is no such a thing as true atheist, because al-kafir is called kafir. He covers that initial seed that Allah has put within a humans on the covenant day. Back to Mr. Umar ibn al-Khattab, okay? Al-Qarnabi recited this ayah and said, I heard the Messenger of Allah say, when he was questioned about it, okay, Allah created Adam, then passed his right hand over his back. Of course, this is not true, because la ilaha illallah. If Allah had passed his right hand or left hand or, I don't know, middle hand or sixth hand on the back of Adam, why didn't he say it on the Quran? Allah in the Quran says just took the covenant. But this is, anyhow, this is a topic for another day. And brought forth from from him his offspring, saying, I have these. And listen to this. This is very dangerous. So Allah took all the offspring of Adam, and then he says, he took a bunch of them, and he says, I have these for paradise, and these will do the deeds of those who go to paradise. So basically, Allah wiped what the hadith, this man-made hadith says, okay, that Allah wiped his hand on the back of Adam, and then a generation of humans, a bunch of humans, Allah knows how many, came out, and then Allah says, this I will take to paradise, and I will create the deeds for paradise, and they will go to paradise. And then he goes to Adam again, passes his hand on the back of Adam, and takes another bunch of humans, the rest of humanity, and then Allah says, I have created these for hellfire, and they will do the deeds of those who go to hellfire, etc., etc., etc. This is absolutely a lie, 1,000,000,000%, if that is such true equation, it's a lie. Where is Allah created us on earth to test us? You test people who have a free will, not people that Allah has already created for paradise, and you come and tell me that is already decided. This is the biggest accusation of Allah being a cheat, of Allah being a wrongdoer, of Allah being a liar, because throughout the Quran he tells us he has given equal opportunity to all humans, and this hadith, no. Allah has already decided, deal with it. And this is untrue. Okay. In another similar hadith, also reported in the books of hadith by Malik, Abu Dawud, and others, and the hadith has been authenticated by Al-Albani, it's called Hadith Al-Qabdatain. Al-Qabdatain is the grabs of your hand. Okay, what Allah says, they say, okay, I'm just telling you what they say, but I don't believe in this, that Allah took when all the offspring of Adam were right in front of Allah. Imagine this, Allah is there, and we are just like small atoms, small tiny creatures, not in body, okay, it's all our souls. Then Allah grabs humanity with one grab of his hand, the right one, and then he takes the second half. So all humanity was in Allah's hands. This is absolutely rubbish. It's like you have two tennis balls in one hand, okay? That's to give you an idea. And then he says, he looks at one of his hands, the right one, and he goes, "This to paradise, and I don't care." Is this God, a fair God, just God, that tells you, picks up humans out of that? For example, yeah, I just happened to be in the portion of humans that he picked up with his left hand. And he decided that I will go to hellfire, and not only that, he doesn't care. What is the mercy of Allah? What is the rahmah of Allah? And this, of course, this hadith is absolutely a lie, a vile lie that transforms Allah from the just that he is. Okay? As he has affirmed in the Qur'an in hundreds upon hundreds of ayat, into some cruel God who creates humans, then decides their final abode for them, then doesn't care a bit about that. It is such a horrible, terrible, miserable, blood-loving God. And Allah is far from this. But this is what exists in our books, and this what has been put into your mind, and because our mind have been programmed into stupidity, we hear all this and we accept them. We read the Quran, Allah says is merciful, and we don't see a problem. Wallahi, we don't see a problem. And this is the dangers we live in. The third hadith is the scariest and most accusative to Allah that you'll ever hear. This hadith is authentic, also reported by Ahmad and Al-Tirmidhi, Al-Hakim. When you hear Al-Hakim in his Mustadrak, Al-Bukhari and Muslim have set for themselves some conditions to accept the hadith as authentic, but they did not put it in their books. But Mr. Al-Hakim came and he wrote about 7 volumes extra hadiths that fulfill the condition of authenticity in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, but they didn't mention that, and is considered like the third book after Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Listen to this huge man-made hadith. They say, "Inna Allah Azza wa Jalla khalaqa khalqahu fi dhulmatin." Allah the Blessed and Exalted created His creation in darkness. فألقى عليهم من نوره. Then He cast of His light upon them. And then, فَمَنْ أَصَابَهُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ النُّورِ اِهْتَدَى. Whoever has been touched by that light is guided. وَمَنْ أَخْطَأَهُ ظَلْ. And whoever wasn't touched goes astray. فَلِذَلِكَ أَقُولْ جَفَّ الْقَلَمْ عَلَى عِلْمِ اللَّهِ. It is for this reason that I say that the pen has dried upon Allah's knowledge. Anyone who believes in this accusative hadith, in my mind, it's the dirtiest lie that has ever been said upon Allah, rendering Him the most unjust and the most horrible God a human can ever believe and worship. So Allah created us in darkness, then He just cast His light. So tell us, folks, did He cast His light? Did He wipe the back of Adam and took from his hands? Did He just look at us? I don't know what He did exactly. I don't know. But this is the hugest lie that has been made by humans, by our own scholars against Allah, when Allah has yelled thousands of ayat in the Quran that is just, and every humans are independently free to do as they like, and that is why there is a judgment day. These concepts of the light, of the grab, of all these things, they contradict Al-Quran headlong. But we find scholars, like big scholars, like Al-Albani, Fawzan, Ibn Uthaymeen, Ibn Baz, Ibn Taymiyyah, they accept this. Do you know why they accept them? Because they have been brought up in the wrong. They don't see this as wrong. They don't respect the Quran. They can't see that the Quran is a priority. And, of course, they have been brought or educated that the Qur'an is the second in the authority after the hadith. They tell you to follow the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah. That's in words. But in reality, they follow just the hadith. And if the Qur'an opposes the hadith, guess who wins? It's the hadith. Hadith number 4. This is another accusative hadith. Again, the hadith is also reported by Ahmad and Al-Hakim in his Mustadrak, as I said, and authenticated by Al-Albani and others. It's really it really amazes me how Albani was just like that. Well, but then again, as I said, they were just, you see, if you bring a bunch of kids and you teach them from the young age that green is not actually green, it's the color red. Yellow is not the yellow, it's the blue. And you educate them like that, and then you send them to the world, those kids are going to see the color, the red one, they're going to call it the green, and they're going to see it as green. Because that's how you brainwash them, and they will not be able to comprehend. And when they see other things, to them, it's always the colors as they learned them. And this is exactly Albani and the other ones. Look at what this man-made hadith says. خلق الله آدم حين خلقه. When Allah created Adam, فضرب كتفه اليمنى. Allah tapped on the right shoulder of Adam. فأخرج ذرية بيضاء كأنهم الذر. And from that right shoulder of Adam, Allah took a progeny that was as white as if they were ants. I don't know how those ants, ants are either red or, but anyhow, just let's go like that, okay? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again tapped on Adam's left shoulder, and then he took other kids as black, and as if they were black coals, you know, where the coal is on fire, it's red, and then when it completely loses its fire, it becomes extremely dark. And then Allah says, and then Allah says to those on his right, إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ وَلَا أُبَالِي. Then he said to those on his right hand, those to Jannah, and I don't care. SubhanAllah, I don't know, you see, I'm having a headache, I'm starting to have a headache, because how can they say this about Allah when he says, I don't care? And then he goes and sees that those to his left, and guess what, and he says, those to hellfire, and I don't care. And in this hadith, there is an indirect brainwash that Allah has got a hand and a left, and he's got a right side, and he's got a left side, and he, all this, of course, Allah is, nothing looks like unto him, but always remember that Salafis believe that Allah, we are created in the shape and form of Allah, i.e. Allah is as human look like as you might think. This is why they say the heart is between the two fingers of Allah. And as you can see in this hadith, he grabbed this with his hand and did that with his hand. Okay? Again, this is just a lie. Allah never say, I don't care. Is this something that would Allah say? Would you take your own baby and put him in fire and say, I don't care? Allah created us. What the choice of mine? If he has decided that I go to hellfire, and why shouldn't he care? He should care because he has been an unjust God. Is God like that? Is Allah like that? Of course not. But the hadith make him appear like this. Okay? Al-Albani, to justify this, he says it in the translation, it is imperative that all these people must know that nothing looks like unto Allah, not in his essence and not in his attributes. Therefore, when he grabs a grab with his hand, it is with his knowledge. Subhanallah. How can someone grab and take something with his hand, wipes with his hand on the shoulder of Adam with his knowledge? Al-Albani, what's wrong with you? And then he said, with his justice and his wisdom. These are words that brainwash you but have no meanings. Okay? And then he said, thus he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, with his right hand, those he knew beforehand that they would obey him when he would command them to. And with the other, the ones, he knew, basically what he's saying is that Allah knew ahead of time that if he commands you, you're going to obey him. And as such, he has written for you paradise. So that means we who pray right now and we obey Allah, we're destined to paradise. And then they tell you, no, you can't judge because there's a judgment day. This is the hugest lie that you can ever hear. And this is how Al-Albani explains this great injustice. But you see, he doesn't see it as such because what he says is never ever run by the Qur'an. And they can never run by through the Quran to see if what they believe is true or false. It's completely detached. It really is amazing how these so-called scholars manage to totally ignore the Quran, because in their minds, the man-made hadith is also a revelation of Allah, of course, which is not, absolutely not. Okay? And they consider that if the hadith says something and being a revelation from Allah, it completely puts the Quran to shame, and what's in the Quran is untrue and I don't know what word to use after that. Okay? The five man-made hadiths I just mentioned are at the base of all the catastrophical understandings that the Muslim world has lived on for the last 1400 years. Some people, when I say these kind of things, tell to me, go up to Salam. All the scholars for the last 1400 years were wrong, and you are correct? Okay? Don't you think like you are putting yourself too much on a pedestal and things like that? Okay? And I look at these people, really. Because I have had some arguments with some Salafists, and then of course they start their war machines and they accuse you of all kinds of accusations, innovators, deviator, misguided, you are attacking al-Islam, you want to destroy Sunnah. Now when we call people to believe in al-Quran, we're being all this evil. So what's the difference between us and the Prophet Muhammad who is calling Quraysh? Quraysh didn't want to accept the Quran. What's the difference between Muslims today who say La ilaha illallah, the one accept the Quran and Quraysh? I don't know. I really, sometimes I struggle with this. But to simply answer this question of everybody before you is wrong and only you is right. Let me tell you first, I'm not the only one who says this. Many scholars have said this, but they have been shamed, they have been accused, they have been killed throughout history. Their books never saw the light, as for example the books of Ibn Taymiyyah, things like that, even though their books exist, alhamdulillah. And they are on the internet, great scholars. They preach differently, but again, because it didn't serve the politicians and their agents, the scholars back then, the work of the other people did not see light, but alhamdulillah, now they see light, okay? And also to answer this, if you send your child, or you, my brother, or you, my sister, you happen to have an opportunity to sit down with the Catholic Pope, which is now Pope Francis, okay, the Pope of in Rome, and he asks you about Jesus. What do you think of Jesus? Well, you are going to tell him that Jesus is a messenger of Allah, right? That he is not the son of Allah. Well, now, if Pope Francis, who is the 266th Pope of the Roman Catholic Church, and he is the sovereign of the Vatican City, okay, with a fellowship of 1.2 billion Catholics around the world. If this guy turns around to you, and him being him, meaning he is behind 2019 years, and he tells you, what? You're telling me that Jesus is a human being and he is just a messenger and that he is not the son of God? You're going to tell him yes. And then he's going to tell you, so all the popes that came before me, all the Christian scholars that came before me, all the Christian monks and preachers and missionaries and all those people that have existed for 2019 years were all wrong, and you alone is right? Are you in your right mind? Can you claim to be really sane? What you gonna tell them? Well, the reason in your eyes that you are right and they are wrong is because you undoubtedly, unquestionably, and totally believe that the Quran says that Jesus is a messenger, not a son of God. Based with, just fed with that information, and based on that information, you speak to, even if you live 10,000 years from now, you will still hold the same argument, and they will tell you, how come you think you're right when for 10,000 years, all all these people who are scholars and they wrote books and great scientists, their mind is just like the University of London, over like a whole city, and they still believe that Jesus is part of God, that he's a Trinity and the Son of God. And even though they're the cleverest people, okay? And you come just armed with one what the Qur'an says and you completely reject the whole thing. Well, the same thing for me. I have the Qur'an with me, behind me, under me, on top of me. When the Qur'an says something and they choose to take the hadith and the sunnah, the man-made text that have been invented 300 years later on, if you brought up the whole entirety of Salafism or Ahl-Sunnah, whatever they call them, the Qur'an wins hands down. Okay? So this is, my dear sisters and my brothers, how the action that Allah has decided, or the information that Allah has invented humans for just what he knows, and then he's gonna put them in hellfire, all is a big lie. One hour and 14 minutes. Just to close this one here, my dear sisters and my brothers, hadith number one, those going to hellfire or paradise is decided, it means no human input. It all is Allah. And this is untrue. Hadith number two, when Allah passed his hand or grabbed the progeny and things like that, he already decided that they shall go to hellfire, and with that, he decided their fate. Okay? And what they're gonna do? Again, no human input. Number three, the light of Allah didn't reach them, so they weren't lucky enough, so they're gonna end up in hellfire. Again, no human input. It all is Allah. Number four, the God we're supposed to love doesn't care at all whether we end up in hellfire or paradise. Is he worth worshiping? No, he's not. Is he worth loving? No, he is not. We humans, if someone doesn't care about you, doesn't care for you, doesn't care what happens to you, you die, you live, yeah, they are not worthy of your love. But is Allah like this? Of course not. My dear sisters and my brothers, I will stop here, and inshallah, in the next one, I will start diving right about the knowledge of Allah. But all this introduction is needed because there is a lot that has been hidden. It's in the Quran. Muslims don't read. And if they read, they don't use the mind. They just use, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's like, it's like those people who live in a country that doesn't speak English. And they pick up a guitar and they sing a song in English, but they just sing. They don't know what they're saying. And the voice is nice, the song is fine, the wording, the lyrics are correct, like the Beatles, and people sing the Beatles, Let It Be, or Help, or whatever. And it used to happen to me, actually. I would play a Beatles song, and we would be great, and things like that, but I had no clue what I was singing. Muslims are just like that. Or if today I pick up a guitar and play a Polish song, I don't know what the Polish people are saying. Yet it happens. So from now on, please, please, please believe in Al-Quran. It is the book that Allah will hold you responsible against on Judgment Day. Next time, inshallah, the part two will be idnillah. I will speak about what Allah has written and get on into the knowledge of Allah. And until part two, inshallah, stay in the mercy of Allah. Do good and be good. And I'll see you, inshallah, in the next talk, yeah? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Again, this is your brother, Abdusalam.